Okay, so you want a revision or we can proceed to our chapters. Revision only, okay. Until what is the doubt then? Okay, so this weekly test Sunday you will have the exam for motion in a plane. Okay. Fine. Okay. Parallax method, fine. Okay. Okay, I'll revise. Okay, so screw gauge. See, I will not give you any difficult questions. Okay, very easy question. Like to find the least count of the screw gauge, to find the least count of the vernier caliper. Like this, I will give. Okay, I won't give any difficult problem. Okay. So yesterday, what we have discussed, I think we discussed about the vernier caliper. Okay, then in vernier caliper, how to get the reading of the vernier caliper? So the reading, or we can say true value is equal to what? The measured value. Okay, so true value is what? Measured value. Plus, or we can say main scale reading plus least count into vernier scale reading. Okay, vernier scale reading is that reading which is coinciding with the main scale reading. Okay, so that is the true value of any quantity when we are measuring with the help of vernier caliper. Vernier caliper. Fine. So that is how we can measure the true value of the any object. Okay. Now next is the zero error. Okay. Zero error. Fine. So basically there are two types of error. One is a negative zero error, and other one is the positive zero error. Negative zero error means. Negative means what? The zero of the vernier scale is on the left side of zero of the main scale. Okay, so if you draw the scale here, let us suppose top one is a main scale. So if you take zero of the main scale, this is the main scale. Okay. If this is the main scale, if the zero of the vernier scale is on the left side of the zero of the main scale, okay, so then that is known as what? Negative error. This is known as negative error. And negative error is always added to the true value, okay, to get the reading that the exact value will be equal to true value plus negative error. Negative error. Now similarly, positive error means when the zero of the vernier caliper is on the right side of zero of the main scale. Okay, then that is known as this is the main scale, this is the vernier scale. Zero is on the right side. Right side means it is positive error. Positive error. So we get the exact value of reading is true value, or we can say measured value. This is the measured value, not true value. This is the measured value. Okay. So the true value in the case of negative error is equal to measured value plus negative error, and true value in the case of positive error is measured value minus positive error. Okay. Fine. So in this way, we can eliminate the errors in the instrument. Okay. Okay. In this way, we can eliminate the errors. Okay. We need to find the true value. Whenever error is there in the question, we have to find the true value. Measured value will be from that. Measured value will be given, or they will give you the condition for measured value to find the measured value. After finding the measured value, you have to add the negative error and subtract the positive. to get the exact reading or the true value of any object. Okay, fine. So that is negative error and positive error in the case of vernier caliper. Okay, now next thing is screw gauge. Now in the screw gauge, can you define what is the least count of the screw gauge? What is the least count of the screw gauge? What is the least count? It is basically the pitch divided by number of division. Okay, pitch divided by number of division is the least count of the screw gauge. Okay, pitch by number of divisions. Okay, now what is pitch? Pitch you can understand like the one main scale division. One main scale division is the pitch divided by number of division. So if a circular scale is 100 division, it could be 100. Okay, it would come as one main scale division is 1 millimeter. Okay, and 100 is number of division, so it will come as 0.01 millimeter or 0.001 centimeter. This is the least count of the standard vernier caliper. A standard vernier caliper has a main scale division, one main scale division is 1 millimeter and number of division is 100. So least count of standard one screw gauge is 0.01 millimeter divided by point or 0.001 centimeter. But the formula remains same. The formula is pitch by number of division. Okay, pitch by number of division is the least count of the screw gauge. Okay, fine. Are you able to understand this? Okay, the next is we can say zero error. So zero error. Okay, so in the case of screw gauge, okay, we have the reference line like this. This is the reference line and this is the circular scale. Okay, this is the circular scale. Now, fine. So this is the reading we start. This is zero of the main scale. Okay. Then if in zero error, we have two types of error. One is positive error. Other one is negative error. Positive error and negative error. So if the zero of the circular scale is below the reference line, say somewhere here the zero of the circular scale is there, then this would be a negative error when it is below the reference line. When it is above the reference line, which is the main scale, okay, this is the reference line, this is the zero of the vernier main scale, and the zero of the circular scale is above the reference line, then it is known as positive error. It is known as positive error. Okay, fine. Now how to get the true value of the screw gauge? The true value will be equal to measured value plus negative error. Negative error. Similarly, the true value can also be written as measured value minus positive error. Minus positive error. Now how to find negative and positive error? Negative error in the case of screw gauge is least count into total number of division minus coinciding division is the least count, is the negative error. Okay. Similarly, positive error is least count into coinciding division. That is the important point in the screw gauge. Negative error will be equal to least count bracket 100 minus mean total number of division minus coinciding division. Here least count into coinciding division. Okay, and the negative error should always be added and positive error should always be subtracted. This is the least count of the screw gauge, which is pitched by number of divisions. Okay, that is all about the screw gauge. Okay, I hope you understood this. Any doubt in the chapter number one? Any doubt? Yes, positive error is positive error is above the reference line. Negative error is below the reference line. Okay, sorry. I think wait. Just wait. Sorry. I made a mistake. This is the positive error. Sorry. Positive error is below the reference line and negative error is above the reference line. Okay, wait. Okay, reverse I told. Sorry. See. If it is below the reference line, it is a positive error. And the value of positive error is least count into coinciding division. Coinciding division. Negative error, it is above the reference line. Least count into total number of division minus coinciding division. Okay. Fine. No. Negative error means positive error means least count into coinciding division. Negative error means total number of division minus coinciding division into least count. Okay, that is the formula for the least count. Okay, fine. Okay, any other doubt in the chapter number one? Any topic? Okay. So next topic is the kinematics 1D. Parallax method. Okay. See, parallax method, it help us to find the distance between the two object. Okay. Like distance between the earth and the moon or a very distant object. Okay. To find the distance, we use the parallax method. So there are two ways to find the parallax method. One is to find the distance between the two planets. So if we take the two planets like this, okay, this is the earth, this is the moon. Now if I need to find the distance between earth and the moon, what we can do? Okay, to find the distance between earth and the moon, we can project the two points. Okay, first point from one of the diameter of the earth, okay, at some point on the moon, say point P. Similarly, from the other point, other diametrically opposite point B, we can project a point at the point P. Okay, so we can see that this distance would be the diameter of the earth. This is the angle theta, and D is the distance between the earth and the moon. Okay, so by the parallax method, can we say that this arc length is the d equal to radius d into theta, therefore theta must be equal to d by d. Okay, or we can say tan theta is equal to d by d. Okay, so in this way we can find the value of tan theta, this theta is very small, so directly we can add theta here. The distance between the earth and the moon is d by theta. Okay, theta is the angle measured at a point P on the earth, on the moon. Okay, this is the parallax method to find the distance between earth and the moon. Okay, fine. One more method is there to find the diameter of the moon. To find the diameter of the moon, we can take the earth like this. This is the earth. And this is the moon. Okay, if I have to find the diameter of the moon from some point on the earth, say point A, we will project two points on the diametrically opposite point, say पी एंड क्यू, दिस इज द डायमीटर ऑफ द मून, से कैपिटल स्मॉल पी, कैपिटल पी वी कैन टेक, डिस्टेंस बिटवीन अर्थ एंड द मून इज डी, दिस एंगल इज थीटा. ओके, सो कैन वी यूज द सेम कॉन्सेप्ट दैट थीटा थीटा इंटू डी, थीटा इंटू डी मस्ट बी इक्वल टू कैपिटल डी, सो द डायमीटर ऑफ द मून वुड बी इक्वल टू डी इंटू थीटा. ओके, वन इंपॉर्टेंट पॉइंट इन दिस इज थीटा शुड बी इन रेडियंस, थीटा शुड बी इन रेडियंस, इट शुड नॉट बी इन, थीटा शुड बी इन रेडियंस, इट शुड नॉट बी इन डिग्री. ओके, नाउ वन वन मोर कॉन्सेप्ट इज देयर, दैट इज हाउ टू कन्वर्ट डिग्री टू मिनट, मिनट टू सेकेंड. ओके, वन डिग्री इक्वल टू हाउ मेनी मिनट्स, 60 मिनट्स. वन डिग्री इक्वल टू 60 मिनट्स. ओके, सो वन मिनट विल बी इक्वल टू, सी वेट, वी हैव टू कन्वर्जन फॉर्मूला इज इंपॉर्टेंट हियर, सो कन्वर्जन फॉर्मूला, हाउ वी कन्वर्ट द फॉर्मूलाज हियर. वन डिग्री मीन्स हाउ मेनी रेडियंस, वन डिग्री मीन्स हाउ मेनी रेडियंस, पाई बाय 180, यस पाई बाय 180, सो वन डिग्री इज इक्वल टू हाउ मेनी रेडियंस, पाई बाय 180 रेडियंस. ओके, वन डिग्री इज इक्वल टू 60 मिनट्स, 60 मिनट, मिनट इज डिनोटेड बाय अ डैश, अस मिनट इज डिनोटेड बाय अ डैश. ओके, सो कैन वी से दैट, कैन वी से दैट वन डिग्री इक्वल टू 60 मिनट्स, सो 60 मिनट इक्वल टू पाई बाय 180 रेडियंस, देयरफॉर वन मिनट इक्वल टू पाई बाय 180 इंटू 60 रेडियंस. ओके, वन मिनट इक्वल टू 60 रेडियंस, देन वी नो दैट वन मिनट इक्वल टू 60 सेकेंड्स, वन मिनट इक्वल टू 60 सेकेंड्स, 60 सेकेंड मीन डबल डैश. ओके, सो कैन वी राइट इट एज 60 सेकेंड इक्वल टू पाई बाय 180 इंटू 60 रेडियंस, therefore 1 second is equal to pi by 180 into 60 into 60 radians. That is how we convert minute into radians, sorry, minute into radians and second into radians. Okay, so 1 degree equal to pi by 180 radians. Okay, 1 second is equal, 1 minute equal to pi by 180 into 60 radians, and 1 second equal to pi by 180 into 16. This is very, very important. Okay, very important. Fine. So please see this concept. This is very important concept. Okay. Fine. And one more thing. Please do the solved example of NCERT book properly. Do the solved example of NCERT book properly. Fine. Okay, understood. So do the solved example of the NCERT properly. Okay. Fine. So first chapter is over. This is very important. The problem solved example of NCERT. Please look at the solved example of NCERT from this concept. Okay. Fine. Now next is kinematics 1D. Kinematics 1D. Okay. Fine. Kinematics 1D. First concept of kinematics 1D is what? Distance. Okay. So what is distance? First of all, now one thing more. The theory is also very important. Like distance. What is distance? Displacement. Okay, so what is distance here? Distance is the total path length traveled by the object. Okay, total path length is the distance here. Displacement is the shortest distance between the two points, means final position minus initial position. Okay, then देन वन मोर कॉन्सेप्ट इज देयर लाइक डिस्टेंस इज अ स्केलर क्वांटिटी, डिस्प्लेसमेंट इज द वेक्टर क्वांटिटी. ओके, डिस्टेंस स्केलर एंड डिस्प्लेसमेंट वेक्टर क्वांटिटी. स्केलर मीन्स इफ इफ डिस्टेंस इज स्केलर इट विल ऑलवेज बी पॉजिटिव, वेक्टर कैन बी नेगेटिव, जीरो और पॉजिटिव. ओके, सो अ वेक्टर कैन बी नेगेटिव, जीरो और पॉजिटिव. दैट इज वन वन मोर पॉइंट, इंपॉर्टेंट पॉइंट हियर. ओके, देन वन मोर रिलेशन इज देयर दैट डिस्टेंस इज ऑलवेज ग्रेटर देन इक्वल टू डिस्प्लेसमेंट. ओके, द डिस्टेंस इज आइदर इक्वल और कैन बी ग्रेटर देन इक्वल टू डिस्प्लेसमेंट. Here scalar is positive. Here I am talking about the magnitude of the displacement is scalar quantity, which is distance. Magnitude is always positive. Distance is always positive. Magnitude is always positive. Okay. When I am talking about the magnitude, it is always positive. Okay. Fine. Then we have a some more problem, like then we have average speed, average velocity. I think you know all this thing. What is average speed? So can you please tell me what is average speed? Average speed is total distance by total time taken. Okay, that is average speed. Then average velocity, total displacement by total time taken. Okay, then we have instantaneous velocity. Okay, so then we have some more concept of instantaneous velocity. So what is instantaneous velocity? That is dx by dt. Dx by dt is the instantaneous velocity. Okay, delta x by delta t. Okay, fine. Now what is acceleration? What is instantaneous acceleration? That is dv by dt. Okay, so dv by dt is the instantaneous acceleration. Okay, fine. Okay, I will tell you the sum. Okay, I'll tell you the sum afterwards. Okay, fine. So acceleration is dv by dt. Okay, dv by dt is the acceleration here. Okay, that is the instantaneous acceleration. Then we can also write acceleration as what? D square x by dt square. That is one of the relation of a. Okay, one more relation is there, that is what? X dv by dx. So acceleration can be dv by dt, or it can be d square x by dt square, or it can be v dv by dx. Okay, fine. That is instantaneous acceleration. And velocity is dx by dt. Okay, fine. Now we have one. We have what? I think you have practiced more problem on this velocity and acceleration. Okay, so we don't need to practice problem here. Then we have equations of motion. Okay, under constant acceleration. So we have equation of motion. Okay, so we have two methods to derive the equation of motion. One method is what? Calculus method. Other method is graphical method. Okay. Now one thing. This is very important question. Okay. Derivation will definitely be asked. This any one of the definition will both calculus method and graphical method. Anyone can be asked or both can be asked. Okay. So do this in a very proper way. Okay, fine. Graphical method as well as calculus method. Okay, so both can be asked in this. Fine. You don't need to take the graph paper. Simply in your copy you can draw the two lines like this. Okay, for graphical method, simply what you do, you draw the two lines. Take this as x-axis, take this as time axis. Okay, this has a displacement, a velocity. Okay, draw this graph like this, and then you find the area like that. That all you can do. Okay, so don't use the graph paper. Simply draw the two lines and draw the figure and then do the derivation. Okay, fine. So this is very important. This will be definitely BIAS. Either both can be BIAS or any one of them can be BIAS. So do that properly. Okay. Then we have displacement in nth second. Displacement in nth second. Okay. It all. I have derived this expression also. Displacement in nth second is given by what? S nth equal to u plus a by 2 n minus 1. This derivation also I have done. So do this also. Okay. Do the derivation properly. This also derivation. Okay. Both derivation you should do. One is equation of motion, other is displacement in nth second. Okay. Fine. It can also be asked. Okay. I'm telling you the derivation of s nth second can be asked. Because I have done in the quiz in the copy in your class. Okay, fine. So you should also do this derivation also. Okay. Now some small points, some small question based on the equation of motion, like b equal to u plus a t equation can be asked, or s equal to u t plus half a t square, or we can also ask you s equal to v square minus u square by 2a. These on the basis of these three formulas, the questions can be asked. Okay, fine. Okay, so practice the problem based on this concept. V equal to u plus a t, s equal to u t plus half a t square, s equal to v square minus u square by 2a. Okay, this concept you should practice, and this concept. Velocity equal to dx by dt, a is equal to v dv by dt, d square x by dt square, and v dv by dx. Okay. Fine. Maximum minimum will not be asked. I will not ask any question from basic mathematics. Okay. Fine. Basic mathematics, I will not ask anything. Okay. Then we have relative velocity. Okay. Relative velocity in 1D. This can be asked. Relative velocity in 1D. So formula for relative velocity is what? Velocity of A with respect to B is equal to velocity of A with respect to ground minus velocity of B with respect to ground. Okay, fine. So this on the basis of this formula, one question can be asked. Okay, what is the velocity of A with respect to B or B with respect to A? Okay, what all problem I have done in relative 1D? This is one dimension motion. Okay. In 1D, do this properly. Okay, fine. Understood. Now next is the motion under gravity. Okay, so motion under gravity. Motion under gravity. Okay, on the basis of this concept, we have equations of motion like v equal to u minus gt, displacement s equal to ut minus half gt square, then s equal to v square minus u square by minus 2g. So on the basis of these three formulas, the questions can be asked. Okay. On the basis of these three formula, the questions can be asked. Okay. Fine. Then the graphs of this means the graph of when you throw the object from the ground, okay, with some initial velocity u, then you draw the graph between displacement and time, velocity and time, and acceleration time. So the graph of this condition can be asked. Okay, when you throw the object with initial velocity u, okay, that can be asked. So do this properly also. The graph between displacement and time, three graphs are there. Now, displacement time, velocity time, and AT graph is there. Okay, fine. Then, so this problem we have already done. Most of the problem we have done. Okay, Then we have the graphs. Okay, some questions of graph can be asked. Average speed will be total distance divided by total time taken. Average velocity will be final velocity minus initial velocity divided by time. No, sorry. Average velocity will be equal to final displacement minus initial displacement by time taken. Okay, fine. Okay, so we have graphs. The graphs are very important, like the graph for the body at rest. Okay, displacement time graph. It would be a straight line like this. Okay, this is when the body is at rest. Okay, when the body is moving with uniform velocity. Uniform velocity. Then the graph is a straight line. Okay, displacement versus time graph. Okay. Now next graph is what? Uniform acceleration. Uniform acceleration. Displacement versus time graph. It would be like this. Okay. Then uniform retardation. Uniform retardation. Okay. The displacement versus time graph for uniform retardation would be like this. Okay, then negative velocity, uniform negative velocity. The graph for displacement versus time would be like this. Okay, so the graphs are very important. So the graphs are very important, like body at rest, body per uniform velocity, uniform acceleration, retardation, negative velocity. Okay. Similarly, you can also find the graph for velocity time graph for uniform velocity. The velocity time graph for uniform velocity. Okay. Velocity time graph. It would be a straight line parallel to time axis. Okay, then uniform acceleration. Okay, uniform acceleration velocity time graph would be a straight line inclined with angle theta. Okay, then we have uniform retardation. Then velocity time graph. Again, a straight line with negative slope. Okay, fine. And then we have increasing acceleration. Increasing acceleration. The velocity time graph would be a parabolic graph. Okay. And decreasing acceleration. Again, it would be a parabola graph with negative slope. Okay. Fine. So these are the graphs which you have to remember properly. Okay. Uniform velocity, uniform acceleration, retardation, decreasing acceleration. Okay. Fine. Understood. Okay, so this graph you have to remember properly. Any one of the graph can be asked in the problem. Okay, so your this is means this is over now. Kinematics 1D. Any doubt in kinematics 1D? Anywhere? Hmax. Okay, Hmax for a body to be thrown from the ground. See. Graph will be asked. Graph will be asked for you to draw. Draw the graphs. Okay. Fine. Draw the graphs. Okay. Can we do some problems on this motion of gravity? How to find the maximum height and maximum velocity? Okay, so like see say say if you throw the body from the ground with initial velocity u, okay, we have to find the time of the flight. Okay, so what is the time of the flight? To find the time of the flight, we have to use the equation displacement equal to ut minus half gt square. Time of flight means when you throw the body from the ground, it will go to the highest point, then again it will come back to the same point. Okay, so net displacement would be zero in that case. So it would be what? Zero equal to ut minus half gt square. So we get t equal to 2u by g. This is the time of the flight. Time of the flight. Then maximum height which the body can go, h max. For h max, displacement s equal to v square minus u square by minus 2g. Because at the highest height, at the maximum height, final velocity is zero. So it should be what? Zero square minus u square by minus 2g. We get u square by 2g is the maximum displacement or maximum height value. Okay, then we can find the velocity at any time t. Velocity at any time t, say at this point v dash. So v dash must be equal to u minus gt. Okay, so these are the some formulas of motion under gravity. Okay, fine. So minimum number of coplanar force, unequal forces. I think we require three forces. Three unequal forces can give the resultant zero. Minimum number of three unequal forces. It is there. You can logically think. Two equal coplanar force cannot become zero. So we require three at least. Okay. हाँ, टू अनइक्वल फोर्सेस कैन नॉट मेक अ रिजल्टेंट जीरो. ओके, सो वी रिक्वायर एटलीस्ट थ्री फोर्सेस फॉर द नेट फोर्स टू बी जीरो. हाँ, वी नीड टेन थ्री फोर्सेस, थ्री अनइक्वल फोर्सेस टू मेक अ जीरो. दिस प्रूफ आर इम्पोर्टेंट. ओके, दिस प्रूफ आर इम्पोर्टेंट दैट इफ यू थ्रो द ऑब्जेक्ट फ्रॉम द ग्राउंड, व्हाट इज द These are important points. Okay, what is the time of the flight? What is the velocity at time t? What is the displacement of the object at maximum height? This is important. Okay, one more concept is there in gravity, that is when you throw the object from certain height. Okay, like this. Like if you take the building and we are throwing the object from certain height h, then you have to find the time of the flight. If you throw upward, then net displacement means the body will go to the maximum height and again come back to the ground. So time of the flight would be equal to how much? That is equal to we can apply this equation of motion that minus h equal to ut minus half g t square. So time of flight will come as, by solving this equation, you'll get the time of the flight. That is, see, this is the time of the flight equation, that minus h equal to ut minus half gt square. Maximum height, how much maximum height it will reach? Maximum height from the ground. Okay, maximum height from the ground h max, that would be equal to apply the equation from 1 to 2 point. Okay, say this height is h1, this height is say h1. Okay, so we can use h1 must be equal to final velocity, which is 0, 0 square minus u square by minus 2g, means u square by 2g is h1. Maximum height from the ground will be equal to h1 plus h, which is u square by 2g plus h. Okay, that is how we can find the maximum height of the object. Okay, fine. So one question is given. Okay, somebody is asking one question that a ball is thrown vertically upward with the speed of 20 meter per second. A ball is thrown with the speed of 20 meter per second from the top of the building. The height of the point from where the ground is thrown is 20 meter from the ground. So 25 meter from the ground. I think this concept I have discussed now itself. How high the ball will rise. I think we have discussed this now itself. Okay. So the height from the top of the building, the height from the top of the building, say H1. H1 is the height of the top of the building. Okay. So we can find H1 must be equal to UT minus half GT square, which is 20 into, okay. Now we are, no, we cannot use this formula for H1. We can use another formula, that is V square minus U square by minus 2G. So final velocity is 0, initial velocity is 20 square by minus 2 into 10, means 400 by 20, means 20 meter from the top of the building, which is H1. Maximum height from the ground, H max, would be 20 plus 25, means 45 meter from the ground. From the ground, it is 20, 45 meters. Okay. Then how long will it take before the ball hits the ground? Okay. See that the time taken. So so we can use minus 25 means minus H equal to UT minus half GT square. So minus 25 equal to 20 into T minus 5T square. It would be minus 5 equal to 4T minus T square. So T square minus 4T minus 5 equal to 0. So you can find the time and get the answer for this. Okay. Fine. Okay. So that is how we can get the answer there. Okay. So I don't think any problem is there. If you know the concept proper, you can get the answer. Okay. Fine. Okay, I think I explained you this problem. Okay, fine. So I think kinematics 1D is over. Okay. Any doubt? Okay. Now we can, whatever the answer is coming, I'm not solving the answer here, but we can find the answer T square minus 4T minus 5 equal to 0. Okay, whatever answer will come, I don't know. Okay. Okay, time is 5 seconds. I agree to your point. Okay. Fine. Okay. Okay, next is vectors. Okay, in vectors, the important point is what? In vectors, the important point is say type of the vectors. Okay, so you should learn about type of the vectors like coplanar vector, coinitial vector. These are all we have discussed, coplanar, coinitial. Then we have type of the vectors like we have three types of quantities. One is scalar quantity, other is vector quantity, and next one is tensor quantity. Okay, so you should know the basic definition of all the three things. Then you should know about the type of the vectors, like parallel vectors, equal vectors, anti-parallel vectors, negative vectors. Then we have this co-initial, co-planar. Okay, so you should have the basic knowledge of all these things. Okay. Name I'm telling you now. Parallel vectors, anti-parallel vectors. Then we have co-initial vectors, co-planar vectors, zero vectors. Then unit vectors. Okay, these type of vectors are there. So you should have a basic idea of the type of the vectors. Then we have two, then the addition of the two vectors. For addition, we have two laws. One is what? Parallelogram law of vector addition. Parallelogram law of addition. And other one is what? Triangle law. Triangle law of addition. Okay. So parallelogram law of vector addition and triangle law of addition, both you have to see the derivation of parallelogram law of vector addition. Okay, so see the definition there, derivation there. Like we have one vector a vector like this, we have another vector b vector, resultant would be the diagonal of the parallelogram. Then we parallel shift the vector. This become b vector. This becomes a vector. Okay, this angle is theta. Okay, this would be theta. Okay, like this you form a structure here like this. Okay, then this would be what? This would be b sine theta. This would be b cos theta. Okay, then this is a triangle. OPQ is the triangle here. Then this is 90 degree. Then what we can write here as the resultant square must be equal to b sine theta whole square plus a plus b cos theta whole square. Okay, in this way we can find the resultant here. Okay, resultant will come as square root of a square plus b square plus 2ab cos theta. Then we can find the alpha also. So tan alpha must be equal to b sine theta by a plus b cos theta. Okay, so this derivation you have to do it properly. This is an important point. Derivation can be asked. Okay, derivation can be asked here. Fine. Lemmas theorem, okay. So if you remember Lemmas theorem that when the three vectors are co-initials, that is this is the a vector, this is the b vector, this is the c vector, angle between a and b is alpha, b and a and c is beta, this is gamma. Okay, then the value of a divided by sine of gamma should be equal to b divided by sine of beta, opposite angle, okay, should be equal to c sine of alpha. That is the Lemmas theorem. And how we got the proof here? Okay, to get the proof, we have to make a triangle of this vector. So this is a vector, okay. B vector would be somewhere here like this. This is the b vector. And then we have the C vector. Okay, it forms a triangle like this. Okay, now the angle between A and B is how much? A and B is alpha, this would be alpha. This would be A and C is how much? Beta, this is gamma. So inside it would be what? 180 minus gamma, this would be 180 minus beta, this would be 180 minus alpha. Okay, then we apply the sine law. Sine law says that the magnitude of the vector divided by sine of the opposite angle means a by sine 180 minus gamma should be equal to b by sine of opposite angle, which is 180 minus beta, should be equal to c by sine of 180 minus alpha. So from there we get sine a by sine gamma should be equal to b by sine beta equal to c by sine alpha. Okay, so that is the proof of Lemmas theorem. This all we have done. Okay, so I think you should know all this thing. Fine. Okay. What is your doubt? I think you are asking me some doubt. A vector sum of n coplanar forces each of magnitude f when each force is making angle 2 pi by n. So the net force would be zero. Net force would be zero. Okay. Addition multiplication of vectors. Okay, wait. Detail what? See, if that see it is this is due to that one more law is there, that is vector law of a parallelogram. Okay, like if the vectors are in parallelogram like this, this is A vector, then we have B vector, then C vector, then D vector, and then E vector. If all the vector forms a polygon, okay, then the net resultant force would be zero. Okay, so all the vectors, okay. Very good question you have asked, that area scalar quantity or vector quantity. Basically area is a vector quantity. Okay, see, whenever we discuss about area, area is the vector quantity. Fine, how it is the vector quantity, I tell you. See, if you take the area, say this is area, this is some rectangle A, B, C, D. Okay, so area is defined by a vector quantity, which is AB cross AC cross BC. AB cross BC. So if I take AB cross BC, the direction of the area vector would be inside the plane cross. Okay. Now if I take BC cross AB, BC cross AB, then it is what? It is outside the plane dot. So area is a vector. It has a direction also. And that direction of the area vector is always perpendicular to the plane. The direction of area vector is perpendicular to the plane. And what is the plane here? The plane is this plane. Okay. So it is always perpendicular to the plane. So if you take AB cross BC, it would be inside the plane. If you take BC cross AB, it would be outside the plane. So area is a vector here. Understood? These are length. Okay, I know it is length. Means AB is also length, BC is also length. Okay, but area is a vector. It is basically AL cross AB. This would be very this means this this you will understand much better when we will do magnetism. In magnetism we will understand that properly, you know. In magnetism we will have area vector. Okay, then this area vector will make some angle with the magnetic fields. Then we have to get the area concept there. Okay, so area is a vector, it is not a scalar quantity. Okay, fine, you will understand much better when we do the concept of area. Okay, then you will understand what is the usefulness of area vector. Distance is scalar, that is fine. But here we are not talking about distance here. You can see, you can imagine like this also. If you take a wall, if you see the wall from your side, that is your point of view. But if you go from other side, that is also the wall, na? So both are different, means both area will be different. Area vector will be different. If you look from inside, it will be towards you. If you look from outside, it is towards you. Means it will look away from you. Okay. That is why area is a vector quantity. Okay. Then we have addition of the vectors. Okay. So how to add the two vectors? That is very easy. Okay, like if A vector is आई कैप प्लस जे कैप, बी वेक्टर इज माइनस टू आई कैप प्लस थ्री जे कैप। सिंपली यू हैव टू ऐड आई विथ आई एंड जे विथ जे। ओके सो ए प्लस बी विल बी इक्वल टू आई विथ आई विल बी माइनस आई कैप, वन प्लस थ्री प्लस फोर जे कैप। ओके सो व्हेन वी आर एडिंग द टू वेक्टर्स वी विल ऐड आई विथ आई एंड जे विथ जे। ओके फाइन, आई वेक्टर विथ आई वेक्टर, जे विथ जे। सिमिलरली सब्ट्रैक्शन, so if I say what is the value of a minus b in this case, it would be I cap plus j cap minus of 2 I cap plus 3 j cap. Okay, so this will come as 3 I cap minus 2 j cap. So in the process of addition, we will simply add I with I and j with j. Okay, then multiplication, we have three types of multiplication. Okay, unit vector parallel to A. Okay, see, for finding a unit vector, okay, see, to find the unit vectors, we know that a vector A is defined by its magnitude, which is mod A into direction, which is cap. Okay, so cap is the unit vector. So unit vector is represented by A vector divided by mod of A. Okay. So if some vector is there, like A is equal to 2i cap plus 3j cap, okay. So can we find the mod of A? So mod of A will be equal to square root of 2 square plus 3 square, which means square root of 4 plus 9, which is almost root 13. So the unit vector A cap would be equal to A vector, which is 2i cap plus 3j cap divided by the mod of that, which is root 13. In this way, we can find the unit vector which is parallel to A vector. This is the direction, okay? This direction would be parallel to the A vector. Okay. Fine. Okay, I think time is not left. Any doubts, they can ask me. See, both are same only. Unit vector means a direction of A vector. Okay, both are same. Unit vector parallel to A is same as a vector parallel to A vector. Okay, both are same. One mark question. Okay, one mark question will be multiple choice question. Okay, in one mark we have a multiple choice MCQ, single objective means single correct answer MCQ. Then we have fill in the blank. Okay. And fill in the blank is there. MCQ is there. One more thing was there. I forgot. Single line answer. Single line answer means very simple questions, but one simple line answer is there. Short answer. Yes, short answer type. Can I give example of one mass question? Like you can this type of question can be asked, like you have to write the answers. Okay, you have to write the answer. What you need to do is that you write down the answer, means question number, like question number one, answer number one. Okay, like this. It would be NCERT level, not NEET or JEE. Some single MCQ will be in NEET level. That too very easy MCQ is there. MCQ is not very difficult. Very easy MCQs. Okay. Fine. So I think time is up. So thank you all. For unit vector perpendicular, we have to use A cross B, not A dot B. Okay. For a perpendicular vector, you have to find A cross B. I'll do tomorrow. Ask me tomorrow, I'll explain you. Okay. Okay, so thank you all.